Today is June 8th, 1998. We're interviewing Louis Rosinger. Last name at birth was Rosinger. My name is Sheila Roden-Novak. We're in Columbia, South Carolina, in the United States of America, and we're conducting the interview in English. My name is Sheila Roden-Novak. I'm interviewing Louis Rosinger. Today is June 8th, 1998, and we're doing the interview in Columbia, South Carolina. Could you please tell us your name and spell it for us?
My name is Lou Rosinger. Spell it L-E-W-I-S. R-O-S-I-N-G-E-R.
And what was your name at birth, and would you spell that for us?
Okay. I was born in Hungary, and the Hungarian name is L-A-S-Z-L-O, with apostrophe on O, Laszlo, Rosinger, R-O-Z-I-N-G-E-R.
And have you ever been known by any other names?
No. No, except my nickname, Lottie.
What is your birth date?
The birth date is August 31st, 1928.
And what is your current age?
My age is close to 70 years old.
And what is the city and country of your birth, and would you spell them for us?
I was born in Sakoy, spelled S-Z-A-K-O-L-Y, Hungary.
Lou, tell us what your father was like and what was his name.
My father's name was Miklos, M-I-K-L-O-S. And the age was his age?
No, tell us about him as a person, remember about him.
He was a tough fellow. He was a stocky built fellow. He was a very strong man, and he was a horse breeder and stock breeder, and I remember him well. Lots of times we had some good times together.
Like what?
Like going to the next town and going to the flea market and things like that, because in a small town you don't have any little flea market that that you can purchase almost anything. And many, many things I can't recall right now.
And what was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Elizabeth, in Hungarian, Erzsébet, spelled E-R-Z-S-A-B-E-T, Csillag, maiden name, Csillag. And she was from Kisléta, a town right next, about 10 kilometers from Sakoy.
And tell us about your mother.
My mother was a beautiful woman. She was a county beauty. She was a very, 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 very well known person. Everybody loved her. She had many, many, many many friends. She was a gourmet. She was a seamstress. She was a designer. And I loved her very much.
What kinds of special times did you have with her?
My mother, I wasn't too close at the point that I remember with my mother. But whenever she wanted to go somewhere, didn't want to go alone, I was the one to go with her, sort of. look out after her.
And tell me about your siblings. How many siblings did you have and their names?
My brother, I had a brother who was a year younger than I am. His name was Joseph. Good-looking little fellow. And I had two sisters. The oldest one is Ava Rosinger. And a lovely little sister. And always said I was very protective of her until the little one came. When the little one, whose name was Lily Rosinger, came. And then, of course, the youngest child was the, you know how that goes. You always switch to the youngest. For some reason, it's a natural thing. But she was also a very beautiful little child.
What was your relationship with your brother and sisters? What kinds of things did you do with them?
We played together a lot, fought together. And gosh, it's been a long time ago. I can't remember, but we always were very active, played little games. And did what children that age do, you know, except in a very economical way, because it wasn't the sport toys that's available now. It wasn't available then.
Do you remember a special toy that you had?
Not after all this. We didn't have too many of the expensive stuff, you know, that's available here, except some of the softballs that we played, and we made the ball from rag and rolled it up and tied it together, and that's how we used it as a softball and made the bat out of wood. And also did the same thing with hockey. We had the fortune of having some people that cared about us not having at that point what it takes, you know, for children to be happy. So just makeshift, we just made it up.
As the oldest, did you have any particular responsibilities in your home?
Not really, because most of the day we were in school. We went to the elementary school in the morning and then went to the cheder, which is the religious school, in the afternoon. And about 6:30, we went home. So it's kind of close call there.
When you think about your childhood home, what images come to mind? Sights, sounds, smells? What are the things?
Oh, the smell was the cooking. My mother was a gourmet. I mean, from A to Z, a gourmet pastry, similar to the Viennese dobosch. She could make a dobosch. She can stuff chicken on Saturdays when we came back from the synagogue. We had outdoors ovens, which we break bread in, and she put the food, they cooked the food in the outdoor oven, which I heated with corn cups and stubs of wood. That was the greatest thing, and all the holiday affair that we have Friday nights and Saturday. It was a special thing. I miss it very much.
When you had Shabbat dinner, where did everybody sit at the table? Do you remember?
Yes. I was sitting across from my father at the end of the table, always. And my little brother was next to me until they separated us, because you know how two guys close together do. They tease each other and get in trouble all the time. So they separated us. And the little sister, the older sister, was sitting next to him, and my mother sat on the other side.
And who got served first?
Father. Father was first, and I was next.
Were there any grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins who lived nearby you?
My grandfather, on my father's side.
What was his name?
His name was Franz. My father's two sisters, two aunts, and that's about it, living close by. And my mother's side was about 10 miles away from where we were.
Do you recall your aunt's names that lived nearby you?
You know, my father's side was Anna, and Julia.
Did they have any children?
No, they were not married. They were not married at that point.
What was your grandfather like?
Grandfather was a small frame, small built fellow. And I remember him as a very serious person, not an extrovert, definitely, but he was a very serious type of person. I couldn't get close to him, not like the other grandfather.
Tell us about him.
The other grandfather was a congenial. I remember him carrying me on his back to Hader in knee-deep snow, and I think they wanted me to be a rabbi. And look what I turned out to be. But he was a terrific guy. So was my grandmother on my mother's side. So I'm a bit partial to them. Very, very, very close to them.
What were their names?
Franz also, my grandfather. And my grandmother's name was Maria. And I know where my mother got her gourmet ability from. Because she was a tremendous, tremendous gourmet cook, or gourmet, you name it, you know. And she was a typical Jewish grandmother who loved the family. And the family was quite a large family.
What were some of the favorite things she cooked for you?
Well, she also cooked. You know, we had, she had a special Friday night and a Saturday dinner. Friday night, you know, the last thing I remember, because of shortage of food before the whole thing started, the mess started, had chicken, and they stuffed the chicken, and part of it was the stuffing and the soup, and next day is the meat and the soup. And so they stretched it, you know. And that's one of the thing. And also the other thing was the cholent. I'm sure you know what the cholent is. And that was baked overnight and had it Saturday with the stuffed neck and so forth.
Do you recall any particular birthday celebrations for you?
The biggest thing that I recall, the 50th anniversary of my grandfather, my mother's father. I couldn't imagine as many people together in a family as I have. I think there were about the 8 children all having offsprings, daughters and cousins, and some of them I haven't met before, and it happened about 2 or 3 years before the mess started in Hungary. I very much enjoyed the closeness of the family, the strength of in number the family. I would say about 40 some odd people.
On your mother's side?
On my mother's side. This is her sisters and brothers and their children. 50, and it's a beautiful, beautiful affair.
Describe it to us.
Oh, Most of my time was taken up with getting acquainted with my cousins and some of which I haven't seen. And so I haven't known. I knew they were they were around, but never met them before. I know of them. And finally you meet them, you know, it's a tremendous feeling. And of course, most of the time I remember playing with them during the golden anniversary.
What were some of the foods like at that affair?
Oh, tremendous pastry, you know. I know they had dobush. I think my mother assisted in that. She's special. And dobush is, you know, 10 layer or more layers of different flavor, and one of my favorite. Okay. And some of the people, some of the daughters and my mother's sisters and her brothers brought lots of food, and it's just like a wedding almost. It's almost like a wedding. I think I could safely say that.
Tell me about your friends in your hometown.
I didn't have too many. I had but three Jewish friends. And it was a small town. And, you know, the anti-Semitism was budding at the time. And you were sort of almost afraid to. And they didn't want to play with you. They didn't want to buddy with you, you know. And the friend that I will tell you about later, who saved my life later, about 200 kilometers where my hometown was in Budapest. He was instrumental in saving my life for that short period that we were around each other.
What kind of school did you go to?
I went to elementary school. I went to a Catholic school because the teacher was very, very strict on prejudicial encounters, and because I was beaten up in the second and the third grade, and they call the Reformed versus Catholic, Protestant, I think you would call it here, school, because most of the Jewish kids went to the elementary to the Reformed for some reason. But my father knew this this teacher, and I'll remember his name. His name was Tulipant, which means tulip man. And I liked him in spite of him being strong, and he was an enforcer. He had a long, he walks soft and carried a long stick all the time. And if we didn't do our homework, we had to bend over.
Did that happen to you?
Not very often. I would say not more than twice. Not more than twice. And he was easy on me because he knew that either I got carried away playing somewhere, you know, with someone, because I was very disciplined in my schoolwork. I was a pretty good student, so I think he was refraining.
What kind of a child were you? How would you describe yourself?
I loved to experiment. I was adventurous. I liked to find things. I was a loner, and I always wanted to be somebody. I wanted to be somebody great, because I had a tremendous mental power that I could lay it out, unlike after the Holocaust. It happens. Something happens to your mind, you know, during that period, especially if you've been beaten up so many times. And I like to go swimming. We used to go to a little channel bend where people went to skinny dip. And we went skinny dipping over there. And I had one friend, Christian friend who I kind of trusted, and we went, you know. And
what was his name?
You know,
do you remember?
I forgot his name. I probably think I forgot it. I forgot his name.
What was your daily life like? Go through a typical day for us from the time you'd wake up.
Well, you first half of the day, we went to elementary school, which was the Catholic school that I went to, and at 1 o'clock, sometimes without going home, immediately went into the religious schooling, the cheder, and stayed till 6 o'clock or so. And it's a little heavy, you know, when you're a young child. I think that's pushing it a little bit. I always resented it, you know, and I'm sure I wasn't by myself or some other kids. But, you know, religion was very prevalent, and most of the people were conservative and orthodox in the area. So you were ashamed in front of people if you didn't perform. You know. So you couldn't get by with a lot. People were watching you.
And after school, then what happened?
After school, you went home, you know, and did your homework. And pretty soon it became time to go to bed. And this is the practically the schedule that, the closed schedule, pretty heavy schedule that we had.
Did your family always eat dinner together?
Yes. 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 Well, they didn't have a restaurant anywhere nearby. I think the nearest restaurant was about 20 kilometers. So I had no choice. And I had to help my mother, you know, prepare the whatever that was, because we had the wooden stove, you know, and the ceramic stove. While things were going well, we used the ceramic store and coal, fed it with coal. But, you know, later on, you couldn't buy the coal, so you had to get wood to keep the stove, the ceramic stove, going. And you banked it, you know, and you didn't have any heat overnight. You started out all over next morning.
Tell us about your bar mitzvah.
The only phase I remember about my mitzvah didn't have a party like they have over here, but mitzvah party inviting people. The only thing I remember is being called up, you know, in the shul, being called up and read my Haftorah, which I recited hundreds of times, you know, in the cheder. That's, they prepare you in the cheder, you know, for the bar mitzvah. And they actually make you memorize parts of it. And of course, you know, before the event, the rabbi opens up the Torah, honors Torah, and teaches you how to read from the Torah. And actually, we read it, I read it from the Torah, not from a book. So it was pretty strict, and that is very strongly stands out in my mind. If I remember correctly, my mother prepared a beautiful meal when we got out, and that was the highlight, because no party. It was during the days, you know, when the anti-Semitism got a foothold, and my father was kept from making the living that he used to. So we couldn't have a party.
Did your extended family come for your bar mitzvah?
If I remember correctly, no. No, I don't remember anybody coming except the immediate family. No, it is a problem, you know, to, for instance, go from one town to the other, because transportation, you know, people don't have automobiles or maybe bicycles. But and like I said, my father's family, on my father's side, I think they were distancing themselves for some reason, and who lived in the same town. It was for them, I don't know, it wasn't important or something.
What kind of a cultural life was there in your town? Did you have any kind?
Very little. Religion and holidays, you know. holidays, celebrating holidays and religion. Very, very boring, very boring. And talking about the times, you know, times were actually kept it from happening. And people were afraid. I started remembering the Hungarian Nazis were throwing stones. That was the time, throwing stones and hitting Jewish people. I remember this fellow who got hit in the head and it was bleeding. I remember just like it was yesterday. I remember that, and then that settles deep into your mind, and you remember that, and you know you want to take revenge, and you can't.
Do you remember that boy's name?
No, I think his Hungarian name was Jenő, spelled J, you know, with two apostrophes on the O. Jenő was, I mean, he worked in the, they had a factory that made the tallits, you know, and tzitzis, you know, that the Orthodox people wear, which I wore when I was younger. When I got bar mitzvah, for some reason, I don't know, I think that my father didn't wear it and I didn't wear it for some reason. But they knew about him working in this factory, which is a religious, as you know, garment. And they picked him out and they hit him. I thought they killed him, he's going to die because his skull was busted open, but it stands out in my mind. That started it.
Did he survive?
He survived as far as I know, but I think then in Holocaust he was murdered because I know who survived. You could count them on your one hand.
Do you recall how many Jewish people were in your hometown?
I would say maybe 12 families.
Out of a population of how much?
About 5,000. 5,000.
Okay. You indicated earlier that you had gotten beaten up a few times. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, it was in the second grade. The first grade was fine. You know, it's sort of like babies, you know, kindergarten. Very lovely teacher. The second grade passed into a Protestant school who was taught, you know, in those days, they taught second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, all one teacher. And this particular situation involved prayer, which is very interesting, I'm sure, of the prayer situation over here. Being people don't really understand, they don't want to understand. This fellow saw me not praying. And a gang of them got a hold of me when we went out after some kind of service, went out and wanted to know I didn't pray. So I told them that I pray in Hebrew. And he says, no, we think you should pray in the prayer that we pray. And everyone took a punch at me. And I believe I was down. I was on the ground. That's on my father. My father was a pretty tough guy. He wasn't afraid of any of them. He confronted the teacher. And he says, it's a shame what you're doing here. And he jerked me out of that school fast and went to his friend who was a teacher in a Catholic school. And I had safety in the Catholic school. I tell you, they don't fool around in Catholic schools.
Okay, Lou, we're going to stop the tape here.
Okay.
tape two. Lou, we left off on the last tape. You were talking about having gotten beaten up in school, but I think you mentioned there was a story you forgot to tell us about. Would you like to tell us that now?
Sure. Sure, I was very hungry for accomplishing things, and I came up with the idea. I love to see people bowling, and I never had a chance. They wouldn't let me. I was too young on a bowling alley, and I have decided that I was going to build a bowling alley, and we had plenty of acreage to do it, you know, if you want to call it that. I have built a bowling alley. I built a clay court bowling alley with the ball returning. My father couldn't believe it. I had somebody to help me to, you know, to kind of clean up whenever I messed up things, but I built a bowling alley. And we were right next to the Greek Catholic Church. And all the young guys that I knew was waiting to get into the service. And they waited right next to our house. And I went out there, and the ones I know I could talk to, you know, once were anti-Semitic, you know, of course, and later on I quit doing that. But I invited them to come in. At first, we were playing cards, and that wasn't sufficient. It didn't satisfy my craving. But after I built the bowling alley with the return ball, the balls weren't round, they were oval. And that's what makes it, it's just like in Italy, except you actually knock down pins, unless you have the king and the seven pins. And all my friends had little change offering that they made or they were given. So they came, they found out that I have a bowling alley in the back, and oh gosh, I had a big crowd, big business going on. It's pennies. And then we pot bowled. We started pot bowling. And they came in with everybody put in a penny or two or three. It depends how rich the kids were. And of course, the guy who knocks down the most pin gets the pot. And the house takes three pennies every game or every pot, whatever you call it. It got to the point where older people started coming in there, and it got to be to the point where they were betting some big money, like bucks. You know, they had Hungarian silver pengu. They called the filler, the penny. It was a filler, and the silver dollar was a pengu. They call it like crown, corona. Before the First World War, and they modernized it, and I have gotten some warnings from people in the church. You're going to have to quit that. My father, they got a hold of my father, and my father told me I'm going to have to destroy the thing because people are complaining about I am hitting these guys with the offering. And they didn't have any offering. Now, all of a sudden, they found out that people just didn't have any money to put in the plate. And I was up, and I think I probably made more money than anybody over there. And then I got to know the good bowlers and the bad bowlers, and I bet on the good bowlers, and naturally, I made some money on it. But I was just barely bar mitzvah. It's right at the period there. Were just before I became bar mitzvah. And I fought and I cried. My father said, just has to go. And my blood, sweat, and tear went down the tube. And I have never forgotten how disappointed I was when we tore up the bowling alley. It was actually a bowling alley that, with just a few finishing touches, could be used as a commercial bowling alley. I never forget the return. It has a drum, you know, that when the ball rolls to the drum, it rolls up and it falls into the little channel that comes, the channel will roll it back down to the bowler. It's quite an accomplishment.
Now, moving on, tell us where you were in September of 1939.
I was in Sakoy, Hungary, demonstrating. Hungary received some chunks back that was cut away at First World War as a punishment of Hungary. The Slovaks got part of it, and Romania, I think, got chunks of it. And the western, let's see, northeastern part, I don't remember who got that, but it's about four or five different countries got, and they celebrated the return of the land to Hungary. You know, Greater Hungary was actually, they had a port. It's in Croatia. And the name of the port was Fiume. And they took that part away, you know, from the Hungarians. And they even had a admiral who didn't have anything to steer. Admiral Horthy was the chancellor of Hungary that period. Actually, he finally he apologized to the Jewish people for letting the Germans come and deport them, and they put him in a concentration camp. And he survived and died in somewhere in Germany. But that was people demonstrated, and I had to be there because all the classes, you know, were there. So I couldn't say whether I'm unhappy or happy. I just was there and, you know, recited songs and things. They had a park in the center of town. And all the schools marched up there and demonstrating their pleasure of returning Greater Hungary to Greater Hungary.
Did you understand what was happening at that time?
Not really. Not really. You know, not really. It was that is a very intelligent question because I know that people made you feel that you had no business in celebrating. That's one of the reasons. No business. In other words, if you took part, even if they pushed you or they made you take part of certain things, then the other side started fighting you, say, you have no right to do this. It's just like bullying, you know. Bullying, and that's how I remember 39.
And how did your life change after that?
My life, after I became a bar mitzvah, we were negotiating. My father was negotiating with people in Budapest, so that I can get up there and go to. Mechanical engineering school or whatever, because I was very much into, I was hungry for designing things and inventing things, you know. With the bowling alley, that start the ball rolling. And right after the bar mitzvah, my father put me on a train, which was the last time I saw my father and the family and sisters and brothers. And put me on a train, and the train, of course, you know, I was a loner, you know, a young boy, and I remember I was sitting on my luggage in the middle of the aisle because there wasn't room to sit anywhere else, or at least I was young, and there was an old person, you know, you gave your seat to. And I arrived at Budapest, and I lived with my aunt.
Which aunt was this?
Julia. Aunt Julia. She was living in Budapest.
And which side was she on?
My mother's side. And I lived there with her, but she gave up her nice, comfortable apartment or whatever, a condo, and had to go into one-bedroom situation. And I was a burden on her. And she didn't have any money because her husband was already deported in labor camps. You know, there's a period there just before they deported everybody to the Holocaust, deported the man into labor camps. And my father was in it too, but he came back. My father cooked for them, you know, he knew how to her cook. And I remember my father came back, and he got in charge. He got a job running a distillery not too far from where we lived. And then it's a controlled substance, and the government fired him because Jews weren't allowed to do that.
This was your father?
My father. So that was the period that I went up to Budapest, and started going to engineering and designing, mechanical engineering designing. And over there, you have to become apprentice before you get a diploma on anything. So I worked part of the day, sort of half day student, and went to school the other part. Different days, different schedule.
Excuse me, you mean half day school, half day work?
Yes, yes. Well, for more than one reason, is because of the finances and everything, you know. And those people gained by me working there, you know, and I made money for them.
Do you remember the name of that place?
It's called in Hungarian Ipari Iskola of Budapest. It means designer school or mechanical engineering school encompasses. It's a name, and I can't remember. I don't remember the exact name, but it's a mechanical school or mechanical engineering and designing for gifted children, or so to speak, like that, because they gave me a test and I did pretty well with it, on it. So they felt like I had a future on it, you know. I was there until it got real, situation got real bad. And of course, Budapest always, they waited until 1944 to start burning, you know, I call it the burning of Budapest.
Okay, we'll come back to that in a moment. Why didn't your family leave at the first signs of trouble?
They tried. I remember my father and his partner, who later on survived, was with my father and told me how my father was killed.
What was his name?
They were going, Solomon. And they were going to, my uncle, this uncle that brought me over here, was supposed to deposit an affidavit in their name so that they come over and, you know, pay him back for the expenses, because they didn't have any money at that time. They waited too long. They were talking, writing letters back and forth to my uncle, and later on I found that my uncle's wife, my aunt, was against it. Unfortunately, it happened so.
And your uncle and aunt's names?
My uncle always held her responsible for it. The blood that had flown was on her hand.
What were your uncle and aunt's names?
Well, my uncle Isidore, that one that brought me over here, was Isidore Katzen. It's T-Z-E-N. And Anna was my aunt's name. And she wrote to me in Austria, well, this is another story, and signed her name, Aunt Annie, mother, you know, trying to mother me, and I didn't buy it.
Was this your mother's brother?
Yes.
Okay. Tell us what happened to you next in Budapest after you, how long did you live with your aunt?
A few months.
And then where did you go?
A few months, things as the grip started tightening. I was really, this friend of mine, you know, I realized that I was told that I looked him up, he's in Budapest. I didn't know he was there. He has the same first name as I have, Laszlo, you know, and we were in the same class in elementary school.
And what's his last name?
Kokrak, Laszlo, which Kokrak is the last name, and Laszlo is last name come first, you know, in most of the countries except ours. And I met him, and he befriended me to the point where he says, don't worry. He kept on telling me, don't worry, I'll figure out something, you know. And he did. He did. He told me he's going to find a place to that was safe, you know, for me to go and sleep, you know, sort of. And that's about all there was. And unfortunately, the first couple that he found was sympathizers with the Hungarian Nazis, Hungarian Gestapo, and he warned me to get the heck out of there because they're coming and get me. And I did, and he found me another place. This is a very swell guy. He took a lot of chances for me, and he kept me, and he knew I was going hungry, no food, no money. You know, when you are in a big town like Budapest and you have a turmoil going on and you run for your life, no money, no clothing, no place to sleep, it is a big thing for a young guy. Well, you get used to it, you know, after a while, as long as you get something, maybe one meal a day. I survived on sometimes no meal a day. But he found me another place, and as time went by, I went up to a Jewish, there were a lot of boys who lost, separated from orphans, separated from their family like I did, you know. But by that time, I didn't receive any information of my parents at all. And there was an organization, Hebrew organization, that sheltered these orphans, which I was also. And they fed us, and I remember them giving us some clothing, too, and a shoe, pair of shoes, you know, because mine's worn out. So that's where I found out about the situation. That's a parallel story to Schindler's List. Shani, if I remember correctly, was a great friend, I think. That's another guy that's responsible for me being here talking to you. He was a year older than I was, and he was a tailor. He graduated. He was a master tailor. And he was working. There was a very wealthy Jewish gentleman, or more than one. I don't know that story. Of course, they wouldn't talk about it. That bought out the Germans, and they told them that you're going to look the best, and sold them about that, and they established huge catering to the German hierarchy, just like Schindler did with his entrepreneurship. And a huge, huge tailorship, and they were making, they looked like they just walking dolls, you know, walking out of gold and silver and the boots and all, you know. And they're superior, you know, that's what they wanted. You know, they looked like they're heaven, and the people are nothing, you know, my people. And that story goes on until they started in late 44, started to tightening the noose on Budapest, and that's when the Swedish diplomat Wallenberg came and tried to save, and did save several thousand Jewish people. I have seen Wallenberg, and I didn't realize who it was. I have seen Eichmann. And this place in Terreskurt was housing the people who worked for the Germans. And it was a willing situation. They bought the safety of these people from the Germans. I don't think they had a guarantee because you know how they are. But they assigned me to work in the Hotel Royal. When I said I saw Eichmann, that was the headquarters for the Gestapo, like like this German says on the Holocaust movie, they became our traveling agent. That's where all the, that's a sarcastic way to put it. But that's what they said on the Holocaust, and the Germans were talking. They would do it over and over again. If today they had a chance, they would do the same thing. But they planned all the deportation from that hotel that was headquarters for the Gestapo. I saw Eichmann about 20 yards from where I was. I got, my job was a dishwasher or peeling potatoes or whatever in a hotel. And he came down one day to inspect the kitchen, see if it's safe, and ask all kinds of questions. Who's this? Who's a Jew? Who's not a Jew? Non-Jew? And he separated the two people. Okay, I want the non-Jews over here and the Jews over here. And he looked over the Jews and asked a few questions of the people who were in charge. Are they doing what you want them to do? And I understood German, of course. You know, Yiddish and German is close. And told them, so we're not going to bother them at this time, meaning that they will bother them later. And one of the highlights of that story is there were some women, pardon me, and there were some women peeling potatoes outside the kitchen. They put them out there so the high-ranking officers could see, shame them in front of them. And just in case they see somebody they want for their consumption, we were peeling potatoes, and a beautiful, beautiful young actress, her name was Lily, was present peeling potatoes with the rest of the Jewish women. And Eichmann's assistants came down and stopped and looked at it. And he says, I want her. Send her up. And we never saw her afterwards. And rumor has it that they sent her, they raped her. We don't know the whole detailed story, but we know for sure that they were raped. She was raped. And they sent her, I understand, to the front or somewhere. And it's a shameful thing, terrible thing. And, of course, you know, when you're young, you see something like that, you want to grab a gun to the next person who's dead and just shoot them on the spot. But didn't have a chance. I would gladly have given my life at that point to save people. We didn't have a chance. Didn't have a chance. They were so shrewd that people couldn't believe. They just say, no way. They couldn't believe what they were planning to do. And especially after they have seen them marching them on a huge circle, six-lane circle, like a herd of cattle, hitting them, knocking them, even shooting them as they proceeded on at that point.
And you observed this?
I'm sorry.
And you observed this?
I have observed it from the back of a truck because, you know, we went every day to pick up rations for the soldiers or the officers because they weren't any soldiers. High, very high-ranking officers were participating over here or roomed or housed. And, of course, you know, sooner or later, before you knew, there was just a handful left, you know, because the Russians put the screws to them and they started driving them back to Nazi Germany.
Lou, I want to take you back just for a moment. When you were in school in Budapest, did you ever see any of your family while you were there before?
No. Not, that was the last time I saw my parents or mother. They put me on a train.
Did you have contact with your mother?
My mother,
that?
Yes. My mother, one time, came and brought me some things, some food. She prepared some food. I don't know where they got a hold of it because it was very difficult. And they took it away from her. I don't see how she got there. They took it away from her. Everything that she carried, I think she told me that she carried, she prepared a goose was a pretty ducks and goose, you know, geese were pretty popular in Hungary. And she prepared me a whole thing, and she never made it. And everything that she had, they took it away because of she carried. That was a non-permissible item. They rationed everything there, and they just wouldn't let anybody bring in without authorization, you know.
Now, this was while you were still in school.
Well, I was, yeah. And it was getting to be, that was just before the period I was telling you about the Hotel Royal.
And you mentioned that a Hebrew organization helped you later. What do you recall the name of that organization?
You know, it was a national organization, and I can't remember. I know it was it was involving a Hebrew organization, and I think it involved children. Children. So I was a wanderer over there, so I walked up in there. I found out from, I can't remember whom, and I walked up there and said, I need some help. And they did.
And you mentioned that your father had been deported to a labor camp. Had you gotten...
That was before the deportation, because that was a Hungarian doing, and the second one was the Hungarian Nazi and the German doing, the collecting the people.
Did you ever hear from your father from
Never.
Any of these camps, get any?
One time I heard from my father, they made him write a postcard. And he hid, there's a way to hide words, you know, to let me know that he is. But he, if I can translate what he said, that they are living well, and the postcard on the other side had the resort picture of a Albanian town to make you think or pass on, you talk about that they're not hurting anybody. They're having tremendous treatment. Just pull the wool over everybody's eyes. Very clever.
Were you ever put into a ghetto at this point?
Yes. Yes. At one point, I was caught, and I was caught more than one time. You know, I was just too mean to let them do things to me, but I was lucky, and I had a guardian angel. I firmly believe I had a guardian angel, and plucked me out several times. And they took me to ghetto, in a ghetto section that they can't remember the name of the section of town. I could pinpoint it on a map for
but
you.
This was in Budapest.
Budapest.
Okay.
And a beautiful, famous Hungarian temple, they call it Dohány, which is Hungarian, it means tobacco for some reason. Temple. Beautiful hand-carved ark and hand-carved everything, very richly decorated. It is standing today. I was going to services, and there wasn't any services, and I didn't know. You know, you can't. I couldn't even read the paper. I was afraid to read the paper of somebody watching me. But I didn't know. And I was walking almost in the temple, Yom Kippur. I was walking, and somebody walking. He says, don't look at me, very under his breath. Don't look at me, but a few steps after he leave, turn around, go on the other side, and walk back to safety. He says, they are there checking and deporting. You know, it's a horrible feeling. You want to go to the temple, want to pray. And you're afraid because you're going to be picked up, executed on the spot. Who knows what they, you know, they did that. And then I turned right around, went on the other side, and they had it pretty well organized over there. And all the stragglers say, we know you were, I don't know what gave an idea, you're Jewish. And they put me in a ghetto and says, you belong here.
Okay, let's stop at this point, and we'll pick it up on the next tape.
Okay. How did I do? Okay.
Louis Rosinger, tape 3. Lou, we left off on the last tape just when you were captured to go into the ghetto. Could you tell us more about that?
I was in the ghetto for a very short period of time where I met a very dear friend whose name is Shanyan. Forgive me, but I can't remember the last name. And he is one of the other savers, lifesavers to me. They were living in the ghetto and just happened to live in that place and they made a ghetto. And they had the full apartment and had some friends who left in an empty apartment. He says to me, come and sleep there, but I'm going to try to get my family out of here. And his father was gone, I think deported before, you know, for a man to work in a camp and everything. And he told me right away that what's going on. A parallel story to Schindler's List. A very wealthy Jewish gentleman, millionaire, established for some reason. He had some contacts, Swedish and Swiss contacts. They were offered, bankers were offered money. And somebody came up with the idea to pay off the Germans to save some lives. And he told me that that's in process. He says, now, I don't want you to go anywhere for the next couple of days because we might have to move right in over there, and they close it down. And sure enough, it happened.
And when did this take place?
This is the Terry Skarut hut. That's the building that all the Jewish people who worked like they did in Schindler's List, in safety, quote unquote.
When was this? When? What time was
it,
this?
It was immediately after Yom Kippur, I think, just a days, maybe later.
In what year?
In 44. And they have the creme de la creme, master tailors, bootmakers, you name it. It appealed to the Germans. For some reason, they have hit a soft spot in the hierarchy of Nazis. And they got one sample. They did one garment, and they fell in love with it. And almost every Gestapo officer that came through Budapest or to the front or back from the front stopped there to get fitted, outfitted, and riding boots and so forth in that place. However, they also needed people to work like the in a hotel and in a kitchen, and that's where I fit in, that could live there. And I became a resident over there, and we didn't know, of course, you know, you know how you feel that we may not make it. And sure enough, talking about may not make it, about a month after I was in the building, they raided the building because people were getting running away, trying to find safety around the area. They found out about it, Jewish people, and they started, like, for instance, Shani's cousin and family was brought in by Shani to save their lives. And Shani, my friend, told me, he says, they're going to come. We don't know where we're going to hide them. They're going to find them. So we were in bed. We knew it's going to be in the middle of the night. We were in bed, and I had covers. And he told me, he says, well, just let her curl up. She was a little petite girl. Curl up next to your leg, so they won't see. It was a form that's under the cover with me. And I was sweating that, you know, but, you know, my guardian angel say, do it, and I did it. That was the bravest thing I think I have ever done. And the machine guns were cocked when they came through. A whole company of German Einsatzgruppen came with helmets. It's a terrifying feeling in the middle of the night. Helmets came through, and they didn't think of lifting up the cover. Didn't think of lifting up the cover. Looked at me, stared at me for a while. If you can imagine a character like the commandant that was practicing with shooting prisoners in the Holocaust. You remember that when he was practicing, he shot typical. I mean, I wouldn't give you 2 cents for the difference. He looked at me, stared at me. He looked at my friend, Shiny, stared at him. You know, he had his friend with him. He had a girlfriend, and he had his friend, and she was right at the crevice of his leg. And there was a blank in my mind, you know, right at there. You say, if I'm afraid, if I make a noise, a slight noise, I give it away. There was some reason, you know, that guardian angel said, don't make a move or sound. And just seconds later, they went on by. They walked through the apartment. They found several people, and they shot them right in the apartment building, downstairs in the middle of the yard, apartment yard, so everybody can see it from all over. So don't dare to do that.
What were your living accommodations like?
It was decent. It was decent accommodation. Even have running water. And I don't remember how we got food, but somehow I think they still had the street vendors in, you know, how New York City, some of the big towns, you know, they have these food vendors and fruits and things like that. Because they, ironically, they paid us so much Hungarian money because they had the money to burn. They paid us. I remember I got like measuring it in the dollars, maybe $50 being worth, you know, you'd sustain yourself for 2 weeks, weekly. And this was going on. After that, nothing like that happened. Because, and one reason is because Eichmann went out of town. And, of course, you know, Eichmann oversaw all the deportation, all the getting everybody together, make sure nobody is left. The system was in cattle cars, sometimes 200 to a car. I think about that, and I get very sick sometimes. It's very hard. I don't care how tough you are.
At this time, did you see anyone getting hurt or killed?
Yeah, at this time, I saw them executing them in the building downstairs, you know, the yard, you know.
And did anyone else besides Shani help you?
No. This wasn't a help, but I worked with an old gentleman, Mr. Goldman, who was a violin virtuoso, and he was, I think, my age at that time. And I did a lot of lifting for him, too.
And was there anyone else you got close to there?
No, except I'm going to jump from here to the satellite hotel that was across the Danube, except they sent part of the people working in a hotel, and they had a Gestapo headquarters, that's a new headquarters, just like a satellite, how would you call it, embassy. You know, they have a sub-embassy, and it's the same thing with the hotel over there. And have quite a bit of, and that hotel had housed some of the soldiers that were coming back with the officers coming back from the front, being reassigned because they had to have a new, I found out later, a new front line, you know, right other side of Budapest, between Budapest and Austria, going west. I forgot what I wanted to say.
We were talking about if anyone else had befriended you.
Yes, the Jewish ladies, and then there was a pregnant Jewish lady so I'd kind of cared for. I did. I assisted her several times, and you can believe this or not, but we were going to sacrifice ourselves if we go with them. And they say, we want two women and two men to go with us. We're going to Germany. And looked at us, and this are the Germans, looked at and say, well, would two men be enough? And I think you wouldn't dare to say, well, this lady's pregnant, that on, because, you know, when they do that, so we take care of that real quick, you know, and just get rid of them. Animals.
When you left Terez Karut, what happened next?
Okay, we went to the satellite hotel across the Danube.
What was that called?
It was the same name as the Royal something number two or whatever, you know. It has to do with the Royal, so the people knew it was the same as the famous Royal Hotel. Kings and queens used to stay there, you know, when they traveled Budapest. It was exactly what it was. It was a Royal five-star hotel. You know, like the Waldorf, not the Waldorf. What's the name of the other hotel in New York? Yeah, that's the same thing.
And what happened to you next when you got over there?
Okay, we didn't stay that long, just a few nights. And next door, there were Ukrainian executioners. We found out because they were talking. My buddy understand the guy, my friend, who I got away from the Germans with. Later on, I'll tell you.
What was his name?
I can't remember.
That's all right.
I can't remember.
That's
probably
all right.
Will have to. It's over. I can't remember what I said.
You were talking about that you were a couple of nights in this other Gestapo headquarters with this friend of yours.
Yes, and we told them to leave the women alone. We'd be glad to go with them, and we knew. And they were crying. They knew that whoever goes with them, they're going to execute them or put them in the concentration camp. And we were afraid what they're going to do if we don't. We didn't know what they're going to do. Were they going to kill the women left behind? And, of course, you know, I had tears in my eyes, and one of them got a hold of it. And this was a Viennese, talking about Austrians not being Nazi. There were plenty of Austrian Nazis. Viennese, better class of Austrian, you know, higher, I would say higher class Austrian. And he says to me, he says, don't worry, they'll be all right. Nobody's going to hurt them. And that was good enough for me. And we just resigned to the fact we're going to do what they want us to do, which was throwing hand grenades in the front of the stores and rob them, loot them. And we loaded it up in a truck and took off with them to unload it. And after they unloaded, God knows what they're going to do.
Before you continue on, going back to this Gestapo headquarters in Buda, you were talking about this execution squad that was...
Yes, the Ukrainians. And I don't know why people sweep it under the rug. Ukrainians were angels. Ukrainians were executioners. Ukrainians did the dirty work for the Gestapo. Ukrainians took blood baths. They enjoyed doing what they did. And they joked about it. They kidded about it, and we overheard them. My buddy understood what they say and told me. He says, you see, don't get involved. Don't even get close to this so-and-so because he just murdered. They just came back from a trip murdering some of the internees. And thank God, you know, we got away so that they won't. I guess they were afraid, mad, because we were working for the Nazis, with the Germans. And, you know, they did what the Germans asked them to do, so they were afraid to do something on their own, although that didn't necessarily hold true. They did it so well, you know, that they... And that's where we were, and we, when we left that place, he, one of the guy, told me, he says, well, we're going to ask you to help us load this thing because, whatever, phony excuse. And he just pulled a pin on a grenade and threw it at the front, blew the front. I caught myself. I remember trying to get in there to load up a very fine, I think one of them was a fine liquor store, and the other one was some very expensive things. It's almost like a department store, but yet it wasn't like a very exclusive place, and we loaded it up on a truck. And I remember the alcoholic beverage was a cordial. They call them chasa curte, which is a small pear, aromatic pear that they make. Kaiser beer, they call it. King's cordial. And it's only made in Hungarian. They made it for Franz Josef, you know, the Austro-Hungarian family. And it was started getting snowy and then getting cold and freezing. And we opened up one of the bottles. I think perhaps kept us from freezing and started drinking it without, I don't know whether we cared whether they know it or not, you know, because we felt like they're going to kill us.
So where were you going now on the truck?
They put us, okay, they were going back. They were hightailing it, you know, from Budapest back to, I think they went home. They're going to get some civilian clothes in case they're going to run into Russians, you know, they say they're civilians. We were supposed to watch for them.
For who?
For the two Germans. Three of them. And that's where they ran into a horseshoe trap.
Describe that for us.
Okay. A horseshoe trap is, you know, like a horseshoe, and they let a convoy of enemy go in, lock up the open part of the horseshoe, and destroy the convoy. We were right in the middle of the convoy. I call it a butcher block situation. It was night, snowing, and the snow was probably about 3 or 4 inches, and the convoy stopped all of a sudden, and we heard shh, 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 which was 3 or 4 bullets. And we looked up, and the canvas had holes in it. My buddy said, and he says, I think we're home. I think we have a problem, and maybe we'll make it. And we talked it over real quick so they won't hear it. He says, we're going to jump this side. And it was an embankment, which was approximately 20 feet tall. And on the bottom of the embankment was water frozen over. We jumped, we rolled down, hit the ice, broke the ice, and pinned down because the Russians were letting them have it. Rockets, hand grenades, submachine guns, 50 caliber tracers. You know, you can see it going right over, and if you raised up, if you moved, after they finish the main shooting, when you finish, if you start crawling and trying to, the tracer bullets will get you. You couldn't even raise up this much. And we rolled down, broke the ice. We were pinned down for approximately, estimating half an hour, maybe more, maybe less. And all of a sudden, moaning, you know, people are dying left and right because a whole bunch of Germans. And of course, they started shooting back at the Russians, you know. And all of a sudden, moaning in the middle of a night, a crucial cold night, and the moon was shining. And anybody moved, you know, they probably, whoever it was, got shot. And we were pinned down. We started moving, well, they started shooting at us. Make a long story short, about after being in the icy water, I said, well, we got to get out of here or we're going to freeze to death. And we started crawling, not creeping. not crawling, but creeping, you know, just like a snake. And we crawled up to a farmhouse. We heard cows mooing, and we crawled up in a little between two rows of trees. So they, I think they probably, they were confused. They didn't know where the snow scrunching came from, you know. And we crawled up to this place where the cows were, a barn carved into the ground and covered with straw. And we heard them moving and went in there, and it was nice and warm, you know, because the cows warm up breathing, you know, and started breathing easier. And all of a sudden, my buddy turned. I didn't even turn. And my buddy turned. He says, "Don't look now, but we have some friends, some SS men hiding in the barn, the brave SS men." He says, "Just don't say anything." Shortly after that, I don't know how long, half an hour, my hour, all of a sudden we hear clunk, 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 like a tractor, you know. It was a Russian T-34 tank. Came up, and this guy was decent enough to say, "Come out, you so-and-so SOB Germans, so I can see your face when I shoot you." It was translated to me. And my buddy, I says, "What is he saying?" He says, "Who?" I said, "Who is it, German?" He says, "No." He says, "They don't talk German." And he was saying that we're going to go out, we're friends. So I was the first one that came out. And then he says to me, "Oh, on the way up to this barn, my feet were wet, my shoes were wet, and I pulled out a pair of German boots off a dead German soldier, just got shot. It was still warm, and tore out the lining of his overcoat, wrapped my feet in it, you know, there. As a matter of fact, I pulled his pants off too, because my pants were wet, you know, and I put it on, and I didn't, you don't think, you know, of this. He says to me, he says, "You Germansky," the Russian says, "You Germansky," and he cursed, you know, of course, you know. And he says, "I am going to shoot you." And he just enjoyed the conversation, whatever he was doing, it seems like. He just saw his buddy killed, later on found out. And he cocked his Tommy gun, and he was ready to pull the trigger when somebody comes behind him. And I saw this Jewish officer came up behind him. He says, "You pull yours." And I'll never forget that, as long as I live, I pull mine. And he says, "Go ahead." And he heard, I forgot to tell you, but he heard the conversation that we are Jewish. We are your friends. Ya tovarish, means what my buddy says. He says, yeah, he started scratching his head. He's half drunk. Starts scratching, yeah. He says, "But he's got German boots on." And I says, "Oh, I screwed up." Makes a long story short, the Jewish officer made him get away. He says, "You pull yours or get the hell out of here," or, you know, also. Anyway, he says to me, he says, he pointed at me, he says, "Explain." I said, "I pulled it off." I says, "We came with the trucks," and we explained to him. You know, it's a Jewish, Yiddish Sechel, you know. And so he added up two and two together. He says, "I want you to prove to me that you're Jewish." He says to me, "Make a brocha for the wine Friday night. I'm sure you haven't had any Kiddush lately." He says, "You know what a Kiddush is?" I says, "Sure." I made a brocha. He says, "Now make a brocha for the motzi, and we'll have a feast. We'll tell the farm people to make you some food." And that, the guardian angel again. Yep. But he was very helpful. He told us where the safe place to passage, you know. He told us walk. My buddy was from a different direction, so he told me, he says, "You going, which way are you going?" And I told him, and he told the other guy. He says, you go about 30 or 40 kilometers south along the Danube, you can cross because all the bridges are blown and the front line was still, you know, sporadic, moving back and forth. And he told me this is a safe way to go. And I did, and all by myself. And snowing with the German boots. He says, if they ask you, he says, try to tell them. He says, I hope you can explain to them. He said, because they don't take any prisoners from here on. So we, I walked down about 30 kilometers, and about halfway down the line, I walked in the place because I was about ready to fall and pass out. No food, cold. Well, actually, we had food then, but it was at night, you know, and this situation was when I walked into a point where the concentration, they catch all the stragglers, all the people who ran loose from the German, because they cut up the Germans, you know, pretty badly over there, you know, different areas. And people walking all over, you know, they didn't know where we were going. And walked into this concentration point where the Russians were catching stragglers. And I walked into that place. They didn't listen to what I had to say. And I was with the Nazi soldiers and everything, and they didn't care. They didn't ask any questions. They just put you in there. So I guess my guardian angel told me to ask this Russian partisan lady, and again, and she was either Jewish, and she's afraid to say so, but I know that she was Jewish. Now, I says, in Yiddish, I says, Bist du a Yid? And she says, she didn't, because the anti-Semitism was present with the Russians. And I says, I am. And I was in a convoy that got destroyed. He said, oh, a convoy, I know about it. I said, they were taking us to Germany and so forth. And she says, oh, yeah. And she was afraid to say too much. And walk right, get away from me, walk right into the colonel or the commandant, the Russian commandant. He says, we have an orphan, a young boy over here that Germans were taking out. He says, did you satisfy yourself that he's okay? He says, yes, I know. Yeah. And I had a little piece of paper from the lieutenant in Russian. They took that, never gave me back. He says, you won't need this anymore. You go this direction, you go this direction. And they let me go. That's another highlight. And I walked around trying to find the place where I go, and all of a sudden the front line was going like this, you know, backwards and forwards, and a Hungarian Nazi truck, you know, who was going fleeing from the oncoming Russians, you know, they stopped, and they wanted to know who we were. And he wanted to know, he knew all about, you know, what was going on in Budapest, and I stumbled with him, and he says, get on the truck. And he didn't say anything else. And he met another truck and transferred us on another truck, and we got back to square one with the Germans.
Okay, Lou, we're going to stop right here and change tapes, and we'll pick it up with that on the next tape.
Cool.
Rosinger, tape 4. Lou, there were a couple of things that you had forgotten to mention that you wanted to include. Could you tell us what those are?
One of the things were the truck driver that truck was taking us out, stepped out of his cab and cocking his machine gun, submachine gun. I looked out on one side of the truck and I just saw his legs and arms falling all over the place, blowing with a big flame in the middle of it. It was just blown up, the German truck driver. The other one I failed to mention is as I was in the back of a German truck going to get produce for whoever German left rations for, we couldn't actually pass. It was end-to-end people walking, being herded on the Kurut, right on the Erzgebirge Kurut and the other Kurut that runs into it. I don't remember the name of that. And there was a woman and a man, an old man, just fell, passed out. And I saw a Hungarian Nazi execute him right on the spot. And it happened over and over again, because by the time they got in the Eastern Railroad, they call it Paya Udvar. Paya Udvar, it's a station, you know, the huge station, railroad station. By the time they got there, probably a third were either killed or somehow, something. And it's one of the things that's in my flash in my mind, or two of the things.
All right. When we stopped the last tape, you had said that you had been transferred now to another truck. You were back at ground zero.
Yes, the Hungarian Nazi truck to a German truck, and then they were still gung ho on deporting, and probably were told that any of the, because lots of Jewish people got away from Budapest from the noose that they were tightening. They sped up the deportation and the killings. And a German truck was supposed to have taken us to one of the concentration camps because it was the nearest one going to Austria. It was just a little ways off from Vienna, south of Vienna. And the German truck deposited, there was a convoy. I don't know how he knew about it. There was a convoy going to the last of deportees from Budapest. Possibly some of the people that I saw being marched. Going to a convoy of train cars in Austria, going to the camps, and they deposited us on the convoy. They were just about ready to leave. They find out, so they unloaded us. And
so were you put in a train car?
Yeah, and they didn't go in the camp because, again, it was such a mess, confusion all over the place. And so people who were alert enough and smart enough to get away from them, this was the time, perfect time to get away from them. And they left us for a day and a night, and then finally they decided, they didn't know what to do with us because the people who were guarding the camp, some of them deserted, and had to put some new people in there, and they were busy on security, keep people from, later on find out, uprising. I found out later on that they were strong enough or organized enough to have them dig a mass grave, several mass graves. So the killings were going on, And I never forget. I try not to pass by there if I could. But once they deposited us in the camp, it was complete confusion. They didn't even tattoo us, you know, complete confusion. All the organization that they had before, it's crumbling. You know, that was the middle of crumbling, the machine.
Which camp was this, Lou?
Mauthausen.
And
they had several satellite camps. And it wasn't the main camp, it was a satellite camp. This was one of the, probably, as a matter of fact, Ebensee, Amwaldsee, they're probably one of the satellite show places that my father was trying to describe, and he was in Mauthausen. And I think I showed you the document. I don't know what I did with it.
Describe your first impressions when you arrived at the camp. What kind of sights and sounds and smells did you notice?
At first, there was nothing, because I think it was quite a ways from the places where the crematoriums were. But as we got closer, we could tell. And, you know, even then, you didn't think, didn't know there's such thing as gassing in crematoriums. But I think it took me 2 days to find out just what was going on. You know, because people were afraid to talk. If somebody heard it and they turned you in, because there were a lot of people who would inform, you know, for their save their own neck. And there were people who sell out their mother and father for half a loaf of bread. There were. It's a true story. But took us a couple of days, and I made up my mind. I gotta get away from here. And I had an idea that I volunteered. I told them I'd like to do something, and the guy just pushed me away and says, "You just talk to me when you ask to talk, you know, and all the mean stuff." And the same person, it was a sergeant. He says, "You just came here." He says, "You want to work?" He says, "Go to work." And he put me in a truck, and several, I think, if I remember correctly, several younger people. And they, I don't know what happened, but the people who were over there, they were killed because they did something, you know, a little small thing they executed them for. They were gone. And they needed a replacement. And they trucked us into Steyr defense plant. You know, they used to make automobiles, motorcycles for the German, and trucked us in there, and that's where we were.
And what did you do there?
I clean job, and everything that they told you. I didn't work on anything metal. There were the people about in the middle 20s, you know, they felt like they probably do a better job than a young boy.
What were your living conditions like in this place?
It's worse than animal. I treat my animals better than they did us. Food, forget it. Maybe you get some dirty soup or potato peel soup. Maybe you won't.
And sanitary conditions?
I'm sorry?
Sanitary conditions?
No sanitary. There's no, they had holes dug, and they make makeshift call it restroom. I don't know what they call it, but some people fell in it and they left them in it. Horrible. disease rampant. People are sick, dying left and right in the three-tier bunk beds. Occasionally they would, at that point, they told me they were much stricter, and they got a little looser when they find out the Russians are coming, but they still had the killer instinct, and they still wanted to perform what Hitler told them to do. And some worse than others. It does numbers on you when you don't have proper nourishment and the mind doesn't work. I tried to think of several things, and I can't recall it properly. And sometimes I have a nightmare, and sometimes it comes back to you in a nightmare form. I remember the very first, still, if I see something on the History Channel, and my wife doesn't let me look at it because of that reason, I get up and sit up in the bed and feel the bullet going through the stomach, see if I can plug the hole.
Did you ever get shot?
No, I was wounded, scratches, shrapnel, but I got knee.
How did that happen?
I guess I was close. I didn't even know. I didn't even know when the convoy got close and encircled. I didn't even know, but you don't think about it when you have other heavy things in your mind, like surviving. But nothing serious. Nothing serious. I was lucky.
What was the
beating? Yes, but not. This problem that I have in my neck started with a German soldier hitting me on top cervical structure.
Why did he do that?
I guess because you did something that you're not supposed to do. You talk to him or ask him something. He was half drunk. He was eating a slab of bacon with raw bacon with bread.
What was the treatment by the guards and the capos like at this time?
It was, I understand when I talked to a few people, they told me that something is going to happen. They know something is going to happen. I got in there is when things started falling apart, the deterioration set in. And they were afraid to be like they were, they're afraid to kill. The air around was that they even said something, the Russians, your friends are coming, but we're going to kill you before, and then they're afraid to do it because they're afraid. They got to the point afraid they're going to have to pay for it. The capos, I didn't meet the real bad ones, and I was fortunate, and they were afraid too. They're going to get in trouble because some of them cooperated and beat a lot of people. Some of them, sometime so ferociously that they died.
Did you ever give up hope at this time?
Hope. Yeah, that's the last. I didn't know whether I'm going to be lucky enough to get away, but I waited, and not too long, and I don't remember how long after I got there, I had a chance to get away, and I got away for weeks or months. And I was all over Austria. I was walking near Wirklichburg, which is a factory defense plant. And when did I meet this friend? This guy was walking skeleton. I met him walking just out in the blue sky. I looked at him and I knew exactly what he was. I knew he got away, and same as I. He says, "So I know the place. I've been around quite a long time." He says, "So stick with me." And you know, we found each other, you know, like a lost little sheep, you know, found each other, maybe we'll make it. And he showed me. He showed me several places, and we kind of got a piece of bread here and something else somewhere else. You know, we begged for it. And at that time, the Germans, the Austrians, they knew, but they didn't want to let anybody know that they know. They were afraid to speak out to anybody, especially people they don't know. And I just felt like that they knew they were going to do something that they think it might save our lives. And I remember I got a bowl of soup that nourished me enough to stay. I passed out. And the woman says, "Don't pass out here. You have to walk, move on." If you can imagine what it is in hell, it's worse than hell. Worse than hell. Anybody old, much older than I was then, I don't think could last. Many people just, even the many other escapees, lasted so long being out on our own in the wilderness, you know. Just sooner or later, the elements or nourishments or lack of whatever caught up.
And what was the most frightening incident or sight that you can recall?
Frightening? Well, that was when the convoy went in. I thought I was going to be destroyed with the rest of them. That was the most horrible thing. You know, you don't think about that when you're a young boy. You don't think about it. You all of a sudden become a man, you become a mensch, and you run for your life, you save, you think for yourself, and do whatever is necessary to save yourself.
So after you escaped from Mauthausen, you were on the road going
walking
where?
All over.
Where were you headed?
We were heading. He was, somehow he knew about this Hitlerjugend camp that was pulled out. And not far from there was a hospital. And he says he got a sandwich or a piece of bread there before. But SS soldiers were recuperating. The Hitlerjugend camp was for that after they got out of hospital. It's right a mile or so from there. They got in there to, you know, get strength and get out again. And he remembered this hospital, and he says, "You stay here." And he just led everything. He says, "Stay here and see if we can get us some food." And I don't know what he told them, but he gave us two sandwiches and some water. And it turned into blood. And later on, we were keeping close around there because it seems like it was a remote area, and it didn't, for some reason we felt like that we're going to make it around there, not staying one place too long and sleeping wherever you can, you know, as long as it's safe. And finally we locked up with the 42nd Armored Division and came up. They didn't fight their way through. They gave up. The Germans gave up around that area. And the 42nd Armored Division came. They took over the, of course, we stayed away from harm's way that period of time We're just watching what's going on. And finally, when we saw the people coming, the infantry coming up, armored infantry, and then we had were brave enough to go hit the army with some food, you know, and ration. I got a candy bar. The first thing I got a candy bar, and with water, that thing is just like the IV, you know, that sugar thing, and just you're living again, you know, something is happening. And we went back to the hospital, and then they told us that, the armored division took the hospital, and we told them who they were, and there was a Jewish officer again. We found them and told that if you want to find a place to sleep, they just emptied the barracks that they lived in over there, and there's plenty of place to sleep. And three or four people have already established their home there.
Where was this?
Up in Kammerschürfling, that they call it, Kammerschürfling, not too far from Wilkesburg, you know. And this was the result, right on the side of a beautiful lake. I can't remember the name of the lake, but you know the Alps. One lake flows in the other lake, and it's like maybe a dozen lakes like that, you know, starting on the top and coming down, you know, to low elevation. It's gorgeous. And we stayed that actually, now, I found out from some Hungarians what was going on, and we stayed in that camp actually, but I went back to find out, see if I can find somebody surviving.
Okay, before we go on to that, let me ask you two questions. First of all, you indicated that the water turned to blood when this man got you the sandwich and water. What did you mean by that?
I meant by that I completely got rejuvenated. You know, like you get plasma or whatever, it completely, you know, you take a deep breath and say, I'm alive.
Do you recall how much you weighed at that time?
No, but I was almost as bad as this walking skeleton I was telling you about. I had started going down real bad. I remember we were walking, and I almost fell. I did fail. And he says, come on, you can't, no, not now. And he helped me. He pulled me up, and this guy was in worse shape than I was. I think the difference being that he must have got some food from somewhere, you know, before I did.
Do you recall his name?
That's the guy that I saw in New York in one of the parks in Brooklyn. I met again. I never forget as long as I live. Talking about miracles. I went up from my school in the United States School to spend the summer. My other uncle, Uncle Sam, and somebody invited me to go with him in the park. And I was walking, I walked straight at him, and he pointed at me, I pointed at you, you son of a gun, you know. And of course, you know, we embraced, and he told me where he lived. For some reason, I had to go back to school, and never did follow up, you know, where he was living. He was a wanderer like me, and he's another one, part of the survival, the high, what's your climax points.
But you don't recall his name right
no,
now?
No, I can't remember.
Okay.
Never saw him or talked to, you know, so I can't.
Where were you when liberation was declared?
Oh. I think I was in Kammerschürfling.
And what did that mean to
you? You know, we didn't have any newspapers. We didn't have any radios. We didn't know what was going on. You know, you approximate. Was it warm? Was it winter? Was it cold? You know, it's about January, you know. And the convoy, you know, was, I know, because it was snowing, you know. And, but other than that, we didn't know what period of life or history we were in.
When did you find out, and how did you find out?
Oh, well, of course, I found out from the 42nd Armored Division was more help to us than anything. They told us exactly what was going on, you know, brought us up to date. And so they told us that the Germans surrendered, and the Russians are here and there, you know. And I believe that's what we were in counter-shuffling.
And how old were you at that time?
17. I think it was early 17.
And what did this mean to you when he told you the Germans had surrendered?
You know what? It's just, for some reason, of course, you know, you rejoice. But I didn't remember any burst out or maybe we didn't have, we weren't strong enough, but I don't remember us dancing, you know. He says, you don't have to. And I met a very decent Jewish major, and he was from Brooklyn, and he told me what to eat, what not to eat. He told me not to eat any solid food so that my intestines wouldn't be punctured, and I was lucky that he did, because some of them had solid food, and, you know, when you puncture it, you don't take care of it, you bleed to death. And they did, unfortunately.
Okay, you were starting to tell us about trying to get back home to find out about your family. Could you tell us about that?
It was normal. About this was the last part of March, early part of May, and a couple of weeks. You know, we had that. The Ausweis, the certification from the Mauthausen, it means that they gave us, I still have. It's about deteriorated. It looked like it's almost normal, and everything is peachy and rosy. And they told us that the American officers and this major also, because he was a busy guy, and he talked to us occasionally, you know. And he told me, he says, have you any idea whether you have anybody left? I said, I don't know. He says, is it safe to go back to Hungary? I said, I don't know. He says to me, you know, the Russians got Hungary now. And he sort of engineered the investigation and see if it's safe for me to go. And he told me, get up to Vienna and just get on, because there are... trains going from Budapest to, and that's all I need to know. Once I was in Budapest, I know how to navigate, you know, find out. And that's how it happened. He kind of set my mind. And he says, you can always come back. And he says, I'll find out how, and I'll tell you about it. And he told me about the Aliyah organization. They knew about it. The military intelligence helped them.
And how long did it take you to get back to your hometown?
Oh, gosh. I would say from Germany, from Austria, I mean, about 10 days or more, at least 10 days. I know it took a week when I got to Budapest, but see, the railroads were destroyed, the tracks, and just little strips were you get a ride, you know, on one of the hobo or something. That's the only ride. And you were afraid to get a ride on a Russian truck because, you know, they might pull a fast one on you like they did on me. And I was afraid to accept any rides. So I'd much rather walked or hop a ride, you know, on trains.
Okay, Lou, we're going to stop the tape right here. Louis Rosinger, tape 5. Lou, we left off on the last tape where you had just gotten back to your hometown. Tell me what happened to you next.
Well, I got this suck horn. The neighbor was living in our house. And they had my mother's sewing machine and everything that was valuable. They took over from the house. I didn't know them personally. I remember them, the only one that I could trust. And the daughter and I went to school together, same age as I am, and she was a very nice little girl. And she was very happy to see me, unlike the others. And we kind of got real friendly, and she was telling me all what's going on. She's even pointing out some Nazis, Hungarian Nazis, to me. And he says, please don't mention that I said, because they would hurt her. I got acquainted, and I went to see the temple. The shul was not too far from where we lived, you know, one over there, and it was half full of grain, wheat, whatever, and it's destroyed, you know, the windows broken in, massacred, desecrated, and then, you know, I went to see one of the teachers who was my second grade teacher that let me get beat up every time, and he was afraid. He thought I was going to hurt him. And by that time, I was a little partisan kid, you know, had a lot of energy. There were a couple of things in between that happened that I'd rather not talk about it, you know, that's for a young boy. But while we were gallivanting around Austria, being there, I was afraid to even call on anybody else that was my father's friend or my family's friend or anything, because you didn't know who was decent, who was not decent. And I stayed overnight. They moved into our house. And I stayed over there. They gave me lodging and food. And the little girl's mother, you know, and they were flabbergasted that I'm alive. You know, almost had a heart attack when they saw me.
Do you remember their name?
Babachi. Babachi Yulishka was her name. Of course, she was pleasant. She was glad to see me, but her mother wasn't as pleasant. And her sister married a not very nice, decent Hungarian. He was a Hungarian fascist, and I knew all that, so I didn't go to see them. I wouldn't dare to enter in a conversation. I wanted to get somebody else or 4 or 5 of us to go encounter some of these, but I changed my mind after I found out what the situation is and my birthplace. It was, they were afraid. They didn't know what was going on because the war has just been over 5 or 6 months, I think, if I'm correct, 4 months. And they didn't know what's going to happen to them, especially the ones that got a hold of the loot, that people who were deported. My mother's fur coat was worn. I've seen somebody wearing it. And, it was a horrible nightmare, you know, to see. It hits you funny, you know, it's sickening feeling.
Did anybody give you anything back?
No. Didn't offer, didn't do. Maybe I wasn't there long enough, but I didn't want it.
And how did you find out about what happened to your family?
Well, you know, nobody wants to talk about it, but you find out. When I went, the next big town was Balkan. I think I put it down somewhere. And there were a lot more Jewish people. It was really, it had a Jewish school, Hebrew elementary school. And you could find out more. There's a lot of more intelligence about what happened. And of course, they were just now getting law and order together, because until then, they had these former Nazis there, and they weren't afraid of what's going on. They think they can just go ahead and do whatever they did. They found out the Russians clamped down on them. And while I was over there, my cousin, one of my cousins, and that's my first cousin, came home. And one of the highlights, the little happiness, you know, and he took possession. And let me tell you, the way he did it, he got himself, he used to know his father owned a, they call them Vendeglers, means a restaurant, a bar, and a club together. And he had acquaintance of some strong-arm people and got a hold of it and went everywhere where he found out that people got puzzled and said, I want it back, and I want it back at such and such time. And I went with him one time and I almost got hurt. So I just, but he went over there and cracked a whip.
What was his name?
His name also Lutzi, cousin, first cousin.
On which side?
On my father's side. He was a character even before. He was just about 2 years older than I was. And I can't tell you whether he hurt anybody or not, because I wouldn't put it. He was mean as hell. He was just a mean, one of those mean, but he could smile and he could be your friend. But I imagine after this, and he let me stay with him for a few weeks, a couple of weeks. And I wanted to get out because he started pulling some fast ones, you know, and I says I don't want to get in a mess around here, because, you know, he acted like he was the sheriff.
And who else did you run into at this time that told you about your father?
Oh, yeah. I got word one day, because they found out, I don't know how they found out, but they find out that I am here. I was there. And a nephew of Mr. Solomon, you know, my father's partner, walked 12 miles to bring me the message. And he was asked by Solomon to get me the message. I have said, tell him that I have information of his father. And, you know, it didn't surprise me, because they were two peas in a pot, and musketeers, you know, and they, unfortunately, he made it. But my father didn't. So I was gung-ho, and I was hoping maybe he's somewhere recuperating. He was going to tell me that, because that was the big thing now, you know, recuperating, getting your strength back and building your body back where it should be. And I thought he's going to give me some news that my father left, but unfortunately he says, I'm going to tell you something. And then I want you to know that I'm very decent and I respect you. And I want to tell you what your father said to you. And then I started feeling like, you know. He says he's always talked about you. He was hoping that you're going to make it and you're going to go to your uncle, because he was going to, him, both of them were going to the United States. You know, they had big ideas. And they would be millionaires, multimillionaires, you know, and all. And he says, he was always hoping and praying that you're going to be there. And he says, I'd like to give you good report. I'd like to give you that your father is alive, but I'm sorry I can't. And it breaks my heart. He says, he was a tough guy. I mean, you know, he says that he was... I asked him how he died, if he suffered, and he says 3 days before liberation, he was knocked in the head with a rifle butt. A drunk German soldier did it. Otherwise, he would have shot him, but he did kill him, bashed his head in. And I find out later on I was in the military intelligence during the Korean War. Later on, exactly how he died, they said, well, what they put down, in our records that my father died of acute heart debility. And boy, that really burned me up. And there's nothing you can do about these things. You can't complain to anybody. And comparing the two things, you know, is just, I got an idea of what the world is going from there on. Of course, a big letdown and kind of weakened me. And I made up my mind then that I want to get out of there. Leave everything there. What the way it is. They can have it. Let's let them answer to somebody else bigger. But I wanted revenge. And again, you know, the Bible says revenge is mine, God said. I still am not satisfied. I still like to have revenge, and I can't.
So what did you do?
I got back to Budapest. And I had a little intelligence on what's going on with the Leo. Actually, the American major, there's some big money exchange, you know, between the Russians and Americans, supplied by some American millionaires, you know. That they let the Leo from one zone, American zone, from Russian zone to the American zone. And then from then on, they went down to Salzburg, and from Salzburg to Italy. And they sailed from there. You know, the boat, they wanted me to join. That's another thing. But, and I said, no, I'm going to the United States. My uncle said I need to be educated, finish my education. And now if I want to go, I still can go. And the boat that carried the Lee and was blown up by the British, we found out.
So how did you come to America?
Oh, it's a sweet story. I remember my uncle's address by memory, by heart. Welch, West Virginia. And I knew his name, Isidore Katzen. He came to the United States with his father, and they peddled groceries up to the miners in West Virginia mountains. And he worked hard in his life. He became successful, when I wrote him a letter, he just cried. He told me, he says, I'm ashamed. I am so upset what they did to my people, and nothing I can do about it. So he found out, he was talking to everybody he could about it, you know, how he can help me. He found out that there's a soldier that living in the same county. Is stationed right next to the almost mile and a half. There was an American contingent there, and he could hand deliver letters to me. Well, my aunt baked me some cookies, and by the time the cookies got there, there's two or three cookies in there, one or two or three, I don't remember. But anyway, he sent me two $20 bills, I remember. And that was good, you know, sustaining and everything. He wanted to check it. First, he sent me $10, see if I get it. Yeah, in a letter before he knew about the soldier being there. And then he sent a letter to the soldier he knew he was going to get. Send me two $20 bills, and then he sent me a $50 bill, you know. And he started going, and he wrote me a letter. He says, if I can help you in any way, he says, I will. He says, I was just talking to Washington. He had some friends in upper echelon, and he wanted to know what he can do, and you know what? They told him exactly the thing he should have done. He got in touch with the embassy already. The United States Embassy was present in Austria. And 2 weeks after he got in touch with the embassy, I was on a truck going to Salzburg. And from Salzburg to Munich, where was the processing embassy, United States Embassy processing. And I was on the first troop carrier going back to the United States. Going to the United States.
And when did you arrive here?
15th of July, 1946.
And What was your first year like in this country?
Difficult, because I didn't speak the language. I understood, you know, I tried to learn some English. I just had a feeling that maybe someday I will, if they didn't get here. And luckily, he sent me to school, and they put me in a school where it's a cosmopolitan mixture of people. And I didn't know how to speak English, and nobody was talking Hungarian, so I had to remember a bit of vocabulary. And they had me entered into a college that accepts students who can afford to be scholars anywhere else. And they put me in that school, in the foundation school, which is an academy that they have. It's sort of a high school going, pass into all the GIs that coming, you know, back. They didn't have high school education. They gave them a GED test, and they pass on to college. And most of them get married, you know. And they took me down there, and I had a difficult, very difficult. They gave me a test, and I didn't answer correctly. I don't think any of them. And they decided that I belong to a vocabulary class in English, seventh grade, you know. And they built my vocabulary up to the point where I went into freshman about 2 years and a half after. And I passed the GED test and got into college. I stayed for 2 years, didn't graduate. Korean War broke out.
And what happened next?
Next?
Mm-hmm.
Next, I stayed out a semester, and I wanted to earn some money. And I did that, and they called me in the Army. I was called in. And sent me a letter and asked me if I was going to school, and I told them the truth. I wasn't, and I was inducted. I was inducted, and after the basic training in 82nd Airborne, they found out that I'm bilingual, and I speak fluently Hungarian. I understand German, understand some French, and it was good material for military intelligence interrogators, interpreters, and so forth.
And how do you think you were affected throughout your life by the war?
I am very revengeful. I am. I want to take satisfaction in paying them back, you know, what they did to me. Unfortunately, I short-tempered, if you asking me about the condition. Unfortunately, I have a very short fuse when they argue with me about something that is not my favorite thing.
How do you think this affected the way you raised your children?
I'm sure I passed on some of the genes. Of course, people tell me that hate will eat you up, but the hate, I couldn't stand, and I still have the same feeling. It just wouldn't go away. I don't forget, and I don't forgive.
Have people asked you about your experiences?
Yes, and I haven't talked about it until I got out of it as soon as I could. You know, when they pinned me down or whatever, and I haven't done anything. People asked me to make speeches, and I didn't until Anne Frank exhibit came here about 4 years ago. And I talked to the kids, and I told them that, imagine I was your age. When I said that to them, you could see their little ears perk up. Listen to and the questions I was getting one after the other. And I was amazed that the children are that interested. I got a stack of letters afterwards thanking me for it.
Have you related your experiences to your children?
Oh, yeah, Michael. I used to carry Michael Sundays, and it's him and me, us guys, and talk to him about it. And that's why he might not agree with me, but one of the things that, he was an officer in the Israeli Army. He's dual citizen, and that's why they were in Israel.
Do you believe in God?
Now, yes. I stood up and raised my head at one point, and I said, there's no God. There's no God. Because if there was God, he wouldn't let this thing happen. And everything is a farce, you know. And you know, shortly after that, I started begging for my life. There's one point there when I saw the Danube red with blood during that period of time when I was in Budapest.
Lou, now over 50 years later, what message or lesson would you like to leave for your children, your grandchildren, and the world?
Oh, that's a big question. It's very difficult. You know, I tell them I always told them or reared them to do the right thing, be honest, and accomplish things so that life won't skip by and life will pass on like it wasn't even here. And I have so much hate in my heart for those people, and I see people around here, right around me, murderers among us over here. And I get in encounters with these people that the world hadn't learned anything about. And I tell them, as soon as you see anything like that creeping up, and maybe I misunderstand the situation with the president, and the Republican Party and the witch hunt that's going on. But it can happen very easily when you have a hate party going after a president to bring him down. Even he didn't kill anybody, you know.
If you had one thing you wanted people to remember, Lou, what would that be?
One thing for what?
If you had one thing you wanted people to remember, what would that be?
One thing, remember about me or?
In general.
In general? Oh, God. I'm stalemated on that one. I got so many ideas, so many ideas. Be on guard, be smart, progress, improve yourself. I don't know, I got so many things, so many ideas about, I don't necessarily follow what I preach, but I have the ideas.
Okay, Lou, thank you very much.
You're welcome. This is a picture of my aunt, Anna Katzen. And my Uncle Isidore, and my ex-wife Diane Harris Rosinger, taken at the home, at their home in Welch, West Virginia.
In what year?
1954. This is the uncle who brought me to America in 1946. This is the Cross family, picture taken in 1956. And from left to right is Ava, Mrs. Cross, Mr. Cross, and Uchi. It was taken in Budapest, Hungary.
And who were they?
They were people who helped me a lot during the Holocaust, helped me, fed me, and befriended me. This is a picture of a friend, Kukrak Laszlo, and his wife, taken in 1956 in Budapest, Hungary. And he helped me during the Holocaust, helped me to sustain and survive. Later, after the revolution, the Hungarian Revolution, I brought his sister over to the United States.
The all clear sign, all right.
This is me at Bulova Watch Company headquarters getting a Man of the Year award in 1968. It was taken in Bulova Park, Flushing, New York. This is my youngest son Terry's wedding in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, year 1984. And from left to right is my wife Clarice, my new daughter-in-law, Amy, and my son Terry, and that's me, Lou Rosinger. This is my grandson's bar mitzvah at the Wailing Wall, Jerusalem, Israel, in 1994. And from left to right is Ilana and my grandson, Usher, and my son, Michael, and the bar mitzvah boy, Gilad. This is my family. To my right is Clarice, my wife. Directly behind me is Michael. And to Michael's right is Usher, his son, my grandson.
I think my grandfather is very special, and I love him a lot.
I knew about my father's experiences growing up from a young age, but I don't think I realized the intensity of what he went through till I was about age 12, 13, right around the time of my bar mitzvah, when one night he sat me down and told me the details of how he escaped. I think that night was one of the first nights I felt very, very close to my dad, because he let me into some of the secret parts of his life, some of the things that he experienced that I, up to that point, didn't really understand. I knew of his experiences, like I said, because of lack of family on his side and mentions of things as we grew older, but not until I was around 13 did I really get the details of it. I think it has impacted me, trying to raise my own children, realizing how quickly life can drastically change, families can be ripped apart, things can happen where you don't have a chance to even say goodbye, and it's even important to live every day as if that could happen, because none of us are really guaranteed tomorrow. I am grateful that my dad planted in my heart a seed that came to fruition when my wife and I immigrated to Israel in 1979. We had our firstborn child was born there. Asher was born here in the States. But most of their lives, they had the privilege of growing up in the Jewish state and experiencing Jewish life in a Jewish country.
Lou and I married in June of 1975, and at that time I knew that he was a survivor of the Holocaust, but he never talked about it very much. You know, it was simply a matter-of-fact statement. I didn't realize the full impact, you know, of what he had really gone through until he retired. and had a lot of time, you know, to reflect on his life and talk about it. I have realized in his later years that he watches a lot of documentaries now, and tries to talk to people about the Holocaust and try to preserve, you know, all of the things that he went through. And I respect him and love him very much for that.